Welcome back, everyone. In today's video, we're going to be looking at the second half of the tournament I played in Grand Rapids, Michigan, the Arnold Denker National Tournament Invitational of State High School Champion Players. Yay. So, in the first half of the tournament, I scored 2 out of 3, and going to the fourth round, I lost to a 2200, so I have 2 out of 4 in the fifth round. In the fifth round, I get paired against Zoe Tang. And this is kind of a funny pairing because I know my opponent and also our parents are friends. So, yeah, it's just kind of funny to get paired against each other. However, on the chessboard, nobody is your friend. So after I start White's clock, no more laughs, only crying. So let's look into the game. After d4, knight f6, this is a very normal opening. So after c4 and e6, knight f3, d5. And also, a funny thing about this game, it won the Best Game Award. So if you want to find out how that could have possibly happened, then you should stick around to the end, and I'll explain most of everything. So knight c3, bishop e7, bishop g5, knight b to d7, this is all very standard, very normal opening, castles, rook c2, rook e8, castles, knight f8, h3, and now play knight g6. This isn't the most common move, nor is it necessarily the best move, but there are some ideas. Mainly, the idea is to play bishop d6, h6, and after the trade, I have some pieces pointing towards the king side, and I'm going to try to start an attack. But that doesn't really work out because after knight e5, white's just going to trade off the knights. So I go knight d7, trading off the bishops, trade, trade. After f4, white accumulates a nice little center here with a diamond pawn structure. So my pawn has a really good center. This knight's kind of annoying. I'm trying to get rid of the knight. Now, my idea in the game was to play knight f8 and then try to play f6, but I could have just taken this knight. And it actually ends up working because normally you don't want to do this because this pawn e5 is kind of annoying. But if my opponent takes with the f pawn, I have queen g5, threatening e3, and I'm also threatening h3 because of the pin. And after rook f3, defending both, I have knight h4, which kicks the rook away. Now, I didn't do. And after the pawn takes, I have f6. And after the takes and queen takes, this is a very normal position. I have play against this e3 pawn, and I can also just stack my rooks, and white has play against my king, sort of. This would have been okay, but the reason I didn't do this is because I wasn't sure how my opponent would allow this. So I kind of trusted my opponent too much, which was pretty bad on my part. You shouldn't really trust your opponent unless there's a good reason to. So I didn't do this, unfortunately. I played knight f8. Now, if I did play knight takes d5, it's not like it would have been better or anything. It's not really certain if it would even equalize, but it would just be something interesting to look into. But I didn't look into it because I just didn't think it would be possible. Okay, so knight f8, rook e1, f6, knight f3, knight b6. I'm trying to develop my pieces. Queen f2. So you'll notice that white's bringing a lot of pieces to the king side. And trying to use the center to try to do some attacks, maybe. Don't really believe in it, so I play bishop e6. I just make normal moves, knight h4. Not really sure what the point of this is. Maybe knight to f5, attacking the queen, but I can just take it, no big deal. Play rook c8, king h1. This is kind of a suspicious move, but sometimes there are ideas of rook g1 and playing g4, g5. I do have to kind of worry about this now. I'm not too worried, but I do have to be careful about it. So I'll play c5, which doing my own stuff on the queen side, queen c5. Now this e3 pawn is going to be the main target. We get knight b5, targeting a7, and trying to go to d4 to occupy the square in front of the isolated pawn. So I've got knight c4 now, putting more pressure on e3, and also attacking b2 as a bonus. My opponent plays knight d4. And my opponent can try to take this knight, but if he does that, I take with the pawn, and I don't take with the queen because then I get royally forked with the knight. That would not be good. So I take it with the pawn, and now I'm actually doing quite well here because I have this queenside majority, and also I can put my bishop on this nice diagonal, and I also still have pressure on this pawn with this rook. So this would have been very pleasant after knight d4 and maybe probably bishop b5. And yeah, this would have been very pleasant because my ideas are just b5, b4, try to create a passed pawn. So instead, my opponent plays knight d4, bishop d7, knight h to f3, putting more support on this knight. Queen b6, attacking the pawn, and after b3 and knight d6, it looks like my position isn't so uncomfortable anymore. So I've gotten rid of one of the center pawns. I have an isolated pawn, but it's controlling e4, and I also have rooks on either side of it, so I have some play on the open files. So we get knight d2, and now I can infiltrate with rook c3, and now I think the position's starting to actually swing in my favor, which is very nice. So bishop b1, bishop b5, attacking the rook. I don't really mind this trade because now there's no more knight on this d4 square, and now I'm actually controlling this square in front of the isolated pawn, which is good. So my opponent plays e4, basically trying to bail out. My opponent trades queens, and now I play knight a3. Basically, this bishop is trapped, and I'm trying to get rid of it before it becomes active. Kind of a ironic foreshadowing there. Rook f to f1. Now my opponent's starting to take because it's no longer pinned. d4. Now after e5, I kind of missed that this bishop could escape. Now I saw that bishop b4 was a move, but I didn't think that she would play immediately after f takes e5. So I thought she was going to take first, and then I can play rook e3. But we get bishop e4 first, and now it gets kind of messy. Of course, I cannot take this pawn because after bishop b5 check, that would be a very nasty discovery. I play knight c2 instead, attacking the rook. And after bishop d5 check, I go to the corner, rook takes, rook d8, and now I'm threatening this fork here. So my opponent stops it with knight e4, but I do it anyway because you can answer an attack with an equal or greater attack. So I answer the attack with a rook with an attack on the rook. So takes the rook, takes the rook, knight d1, stopping knight e3, and also blocking this pawn in the future. So I play knight g6, attacking the rook, rook goes to e1. And now I cannot take this bishop because my opponent doesn't take the knight, but just back ranks me. That would have been a disaster. That's why I said no laughs, only crime. How luckily that does not happen. Instead of take on f4, we get takes. So my opponent just grabs this pawn, which could be useful in the future. Because if my opponent actually ever has to sack a knight for this pawn, at least there's these two pawns which could create some drawing chances. So we get takes, check, and now my opponent makes a slight mistake by playing king g1, trying to activate the king. Instead, what she should have done is king h2 to attack the knight, which would have stopped my idea of playing h5 and h4 to solidify this knight and also create some lift for my king. So we get b4 now, rook f8. I'm trying to set up this checkmating pattern. My opponent kind of prolongs it with king f2, which gives her more time to stop it. I play knight d5. There's a lot of knight moves I can play. I can go to g6, I can go to e2, I can go to d3 maybe. But I decided to go to d5 to attack the rook and also attack this pawn so that after d1 I can take the pawn. However, my opponent can just take the knight because it's not exactly checkmate. My opponent can sack the knight back to stop it and then play bishop c4 to stop the rook from going back. So bishop c4, the bishop here is taking advantage of very nice geometry. So it's stopping this, it's covering this, and I cannot go rook c2 because after check and bishop d3, that would be a very nasty fork. And also, my opponent is also stopping rook b2 because after a3, I cannot go rook b1 because there's still this fork. So very annoying. So what do I do? I play g5 to try to stop this. The idea is to allow the king to run to g7 after rook c2 or rook b2 to b1. However, now my opponent just takes this pawn, and at this point I'm thinking, wait, what? Can't I just go rook c2 now? I'm threatening to go rook c1, I'm threatening the bishop. Well, this is the case where you should kind of trust your opponent, because a fide master wouldn't just take that pawn and allow rook c2, right? Well, yeah, a fide master would not allow that. And the idea is rook h7 check. Very, very nasty. The king has to take the rook, and then bishop d3 check. This would have been a disaster. This would have been more crime. However, fortunately, this does not happen either. And I do manage to see this because I do a lot of puzzle rush. So this is why you should do your puzzle rush. So rook d2 instead. King g1, rook b2, a3. And this is kind of just fizzling out now. There are still some tricks with knight e4 guarding this diagonal. Now the idea is to play with maybe a move like b5, rook b1 check, and then not knight g3 because there's still the cheese. But rook c1 first, stepping out of it, and then knight g3 would be very strong. My opponent doesn't allow this, plays bishop d3 instead. Knight f2, trying to escort the pawn. Now play d2, kind of another trick. King f2 would be a blunder because of d1 queen with the discovered check. Bishop e2 instead, and now g4, another very nice move, creating more air for the king. I have to take en passant. King f1, and now basically I just make the queen. And the only chance that I would ever have to win this game is taking all the pawns, and somehow my opponent blunders in rook and knight versus rook. And rook and knight versus rook is a pretty easy draw. It's a lot easier than rook and knight versus bishop. It's a lot easier than rook versus rook and bishop. So I kind of have to take these pawns. So I just take the pawns, take the pawn. So this is why taking this pawn and taking this pawn is useful, because otherwise it might be a little dangerous if I can protect this g pawn. But now I have to focus on taking these pawns first so I don't lose the game accidentally. So takes takes, king f6. Now I cannot take the knight because that would be a backrank check. Checkmate, that would be even more crying. I think I've said the word crying 5 times now in this video. So I take with the rook instead. Now, after rook b8, white would be the one crying because I just take the rook. I guess there's rook a7 to keep the game going, but then I just have to play rook to f6. So my opponent does just have to take the rook, and then I do a little funny stuff, get the knight in the corner, and then take the pawn, and the game does end in a draw. So draw is a pretty peaceful result, but this game was anything but peaceful. It was very bloody. There were many points where it would have been a disaster. However, they were all kind of avoided, and there wasn't actually really a point where one of us was really winning. It was kind of a smooth game with a lot of swings in like momentum and initiative, whatever. Okay, so I did say that this game won the Best Game Award. How did that happen? Well, the nominations for the Best Game Award are you have to submit the game. So you have to have the shameless audacity to submit your game as the best game, and not a lot of people have that. And I think only two or three other people submitted a game along with me, and this game actually happened to be the best game. So that's obviously subjective. There was a judge, and the judge was, I think, the 2014 Herring winner. The Herring is the girls' tournament. So she chose this game for some reason. I'm not really sure. I'm kind of curious what the other games were, how bad they were to not have been chosen over this one. But I am very happy to win that award. I got a $100 gift certificate. I bought some books from the chess store, something like that. And so that was the fifth game. I have 2.5 out of 5. And in the sixth game, I get another FIDE Master from California. I actually draw that game, so I get 3 out of 6 in the dankers. That's a pretty good result for me, considering that I'm from the lowly state of Idaho, where, yeah, really needs no other explanation. So I'm pretty happy with my result. And in the next video, I'm going to be showing some games from the U.S. Open, which was right after this tournament. So I'll see you guys at that video. And also, one more thing: my opponent Zoe Tang also has a YouTube channel. I might link that in the description, and you might want to go check that out. Maybe. Yeah, bye everyone.